Thank you, everybody. We will actually be reconvening, resuming the regular meeting. We just came out of executive session for the purpose of the village manager's annual review, which we will be taking up in legislation. Announcements from council.
Yeah, actually, I have a couple things, and they're related to the schools. First of all, I wanted to give a shout-out to the police department. We heard in a meeting last week that Mario, our superintendent, is thrilled to see the presence in the morning, so I think that's great, and I know the community really values it, so thank you, Chief Hale, for responding to that. And the second thing is, I wanted to also highlight a project-based learning project that's happening in Ms. Morgan's third-grade class that involves all of us. It is, they are studying local government, and they have been interviewing village manager, assistant village manager. I was interviewed today, so it's on my mind. And there were two things they wanted, that they mentioned. One is that they are planning next steps, which will be initiated by the students. And one idea they have, I think because of Judy, is maybe bringing a resolution to us. So Ms. Morgan just wanted me to mention that we'll see some things happening. And the second comment was that they thought the new website was incredibly user-friendly and really helped them prepare for this project.
So I was
really happy to hear that. And I just wanted to make sure, in case council wasn't clear on the protocol, because I know they want to talk to all of us, that you're supposed to email mmorgan@ysschools.org, and then she will send you times to be interviewed by them. And it's really cool.
I've got a couple things. One, because this day is particularly meaningful to me because my father-in-law was a Pearl Harbor survivor. I just wanted to recognize this as Pearl Harbor Day. And also, on a positive and happy note, the Yellow Springs Shop local bag. This is, you can buy these at 20, well, I don't, you can buy them, I think, at 15 locations. There are coupons and discounts at 20 different stores. There's 24 different discounts at 24 different locations. They cost $10. The proceeds go to the high school scholarship fund and to the police coat fund of the sale of the bag. And the value of what's in the bag is far beyond the $10 price, and they're cute bags, so please participate.
I have one announcement. I did get an email from the chief. Apparently we had a citizen request that he purchase some autism ID cards for people to have and carry if they are autistic, and so the police department now does have those, so if someone is autistic and would like to carry one of those cards that they can show to someone to get assistance or explain something, then the PD does have those.
Great.
Karen, did you want to say anything about Holiday Fest?
I guess I could, yeah. This Saturday is Holiday Fest. There will, actually the big event is at Mills Lawn. They're doing a gingerbread festival, so any of you bakers who want to craft your own gingerbread house can do that. There is a sign-up process that you have to go through, but the fun thing that they're going to be doing is actually having graham crackers and royal frosting and candies that day in the gym so that kids can build their own little gingerbread houses. This is all being done by the PTO, by the Mills Lawn PTO, and they have done an incredible job. Santa will be there from 1 to 4, and there will be free carriage rides from noon until 3. Those will be starting at Mills Lawn. And there's other activities going on. There's a Victorian toy discussion and a show with Victorian toys. The Little Art will have a movie. Which one is it this week, Brian?
It's Polar Express.
Polar Express. That's at 11:30 for free for 14 and under with an adult. And then what's happening that night? There will be fire truck rides from 4 until 6, and there will be the cookie contest and concert at the Yellow Springs Arts Council.
Yeah, Heartstrings.
Heartstrings, yes. Okay, lots going on. Mm-hmm. It's the season. And I will extend appreciation to the electric crew for our lovely lights and up very early, so that was nice. Okay, our consent agenda includes the minutes of October 29th, the special council meeting and work session, and then the minutes of November 16th, regular meeting. And I guess I have to ask Judy, are there changes to the minutes? Were there minutes at our desk?
There were minutes at your desk, which had some, I don't think there were any substantial changes.
So typos?
Typos and.
Okay. So the basic content of the minutes are the same. Can I get a motion to approve?
I move.
Consent agenda?
I move that we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Next, moving on to the review of the agenda, we do have one item to add to the, we'll add it to new business. We have Pete Williams from the Greene County Department of Development coming to talk to us about a, I think, pretty exciting announcement.
Okay. All right, well, I will cover.
Is there anything, wait, hold, is there anything else we want to add or change in the agenda?
Well, at our last meeting, when we were voting on one of the ordinances, and I don't have my agenda is lost mm-hmm. in my paperwork. We didn't vote on the one that had not made a change for right. accessory dwelling.
Right, and I apologize that I did not get the explanation in writing to council, but I do have that explanation when we get to that piece of legislation.
So is that included? Was the legislation changed or?
No, and there's a reason.
Okay.
So I think we'll address it when we get there.
Okay.
So Lori, for the petitions and communications, please.
Okay. The Hergesheimers wrote a thank you to the village crew for the sidewalks between Herman and Allen Street. Al Schleter wrote a second time regarding the ACE task force. He is still against it and believes we need to do more in terms of supporting the challenges of addiction in our community. Julius Eason wrote opposing our participation in the task force. Aaron Burke wrote with ideas about the gap in what the task force will be doing for our community should we decide to leave the task force, and she is for leaving the task force, so against the task force. Franklin Hallie, who's of TCN, wrote with additional information about things that ways that TCN can support Yellow Springs and what we want to accomplish. Joyce Robinson wrote in favor of staying in the task force and that the police chief should decide, and that viewpoint was seconded by Sue Abendroth, who also wrote in favor of the task force. Karen included, and I did find it, I just apparently can't see when I'm in a hurry, did include the information on the heroin epidemic from
Stephen Mr. Haller.
Haller. Yes,
Prosecutor Haller.
And then the rest were not.
I just wanted to note that the family solutions piece, that would came from Franklin Hallie.
Oh,
That piece was connected, talking about the services that he's currently providing, that they're currently
right.
providing in the schools.
Okay. All right. So that was all I was going to cover here, if anybody wants to pick up on anything in the more general pieces from that. There's pieces from NAMI and from Next Cities regarding broadband and from Greene County
Actually,
Health Department about the mosquitoes.
Did just want to say something about the Next Century Cities.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. So I don't know if everyone's familiar with the Lifeline program, but this is one of the things, Next Century Cities, we joined about a year ago to support community-based initiatives for broadband, high-speed internet. And the Lifeline program is currently a program that provides a subsidy for low-income individuals with their phones, and they're trying to get it extended to being able to provide a subsidy for internet. We did sign on to this letter, as we have with other things that the village supports. We empowered Patty to agree to those things, and my name has gone on them. And what's exciting is, if we do in fact get the our community-based broadband, this could be a way for us to offer lower prices to individuals in need. Obviously, I think most people realize internet is, if you don't have internet in this day and age, that is a big problem. It's a necessity, and this is something that the schools have talked a lot about, and we certainly support as well.
Thanks, Brian. Everybody, that just reminded me to ask you to please turn off your cell phones. Thank you. So we'll move on to public hearings and legislation. First is ordinance 2015-18.
Okay, shall I just read the
yes,
totals
and then
on this one?
And then we can review it.
Okay, whereas ordinances 2014-29 and 2015-10 were adopted to make appropriations for current expenses and other expenditures of the Village of Yellow Springs, State of Ohio, during the fiscal year ending December 31, 2015, and whereas Village Council makes supplemental appropriations to reflect adjustments which occur throughout the fiscal year, and whereas this ordinance is declared to be an emergency measure necessary to preserve the public interest and provide for a special emergency in the operation of village services, such emergency being the urgent necessity to provide for legitimate expenditures and to amend the annual appropriation. Now, therefore, the Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, hereby ordains that Section 1, to provide for expenses and other expenditures of the said Village of Yellow Springs during the fiscal year ending December 31, 2015, the following sums are hereby set aside and appropriated as follows. Section 2, that there be appropriated from the general fund. The current budget is $3,805,652. The supplemental is $11,000. The amended budget is $3,816,652. Section 3, that there be appropriated from the following special revenue funds. The current budget is $1,239,701. The supplemental is less $11,150,000. And the amended budget is $1,228,551. Section 4, that there be appropriated from the capital project funds. The current budget is $930,000. The supplemental is $426,250. The amended budget is $1,356,250. Section 5, that there be appropriated from the enterprise funds. The current budget is $5,306,940. The supplemental is $551,220. And the amended budget is $5,858,160. Section 7, that the appropriation from the total fund budget is as follows. The current budget, $11,282,293. The supplemental, $977,320. And the amended budget, $12,259,613. Section 8, the finance director and village manager are hereby authorized to draw warrants on the village treasury for payments from any of the foregoing appropriations upon receiving proper certificates and vouchers, therefore, approved by an ordinance of council to make the expenditures, provided that no warrants shall be drawn or paid for salaries or wages except to persons employed by authority of and in accordance with such ordinance. Section 9, this ordinance is hereby declared to be an emergency measure immediately necessary to preserve the public interest and for the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens of the village. Wherefore, this ordinance shall be in effect immediately upon adoption by council.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Melissa, I assume this will be yours.
Yes, and what I did was I drew up a worksheet that ties in with the ordinance that basically serves two different purposes. It shows me where to put the money, and it also gives an explanation for what the money is going towards. Most of these things council already knew about. I'll go through these quickly. From the general fund, the auditor, if you all remember back when I presented the budget, there was a $5,100 estate tax refund that was deducted from our second half property taxes. So we didn't plan for that because it was from 2013. So I had to appropriate that to keep that fund from going in a negative, or that line from going into a negative balance. Let's see, cable was to allocate station manager services after the contract that was written up that happened later. Planning, let's see. Oh, I'm sorry, human relations, that was from a refund from the YS Community Foundation that we had to give back from the Miller Fellows so it would not interrupt their normal budget. So I did that. So that's the $11,000 in the general fund. In the special revenue funds, ODOT Safe Route to School was not going to happen this year, and we had originally appropriated $90,000, so there's that reduction there. We have the State Highway Fund, which that, along with the permissive tax fund, we decided that we were going to get battery backups for the streetlights on 68, or Xenia Avenue, and also on Dayton Street. So there were $17,250 coming out of each of those for those battery backups for the lights that are along those routes. We had, out of Parks and Recreation, we had some personnel costs that came out of the pool since we had one of our staff members down there, which was not originally appropriated for, so we've got moving that money into that line. We also had, at the Bryan Center, there were some employees that picked up health insurance benefits that were not originally planned for, and we also had the boiler that went down, so that makes up for that $20,000, $15,000 in personnel and $5,000 for the boiler. Bryan Youth Center, they had some additional fundraising, so that's going to cover their holiday party that they're going to be having. We talked about permissive tax, Mayor's Court Computer Fund, just a very minor amount of money to cover costs this year. Coats and supplies, I had undershot that a little bit, so I was appropriating more money to cover the actual cost and to brace for anything else that may come in for the month of December. Federal Forfeited Assets Fund, there was a little bit more money that was spent out of there. It was just for some supplies, some random supplies didn't amount to much. State Law Enforcement Trust Fund, there was a little bit more that came out of that than what was originally planned for, to the tune of $4,500. These were all just miscellaneous supplies. And then the Police Pension Fund was undershot by about $10,000. So that makes up the Special Revenue Fund. So the net was a reduction of $11,150, but most of that was because of that big reduction in Safe Routes to School. If we go to the capital project funds, this and the enterprise fund, which are making up the bulk of this appropriation amount, bottom line, because of the OPWC loop completion grant, I have to appropriate out the money that we received in from the loan. So that will zero out that fund. It's actually going to be moving to two different places. It's going to pay back the general fund the amount of $405,000. And then the actual project came in a little bit lower than anticipated by $16,250. So that will go back to the water fund, since that's where the loan will be paid from. So that will zero out the OPWC loop completion grant fund, since that project will be completed. So I do have to appropriate that money, even though we got the loan money receipted into that fund. So let's see, then we've got $5,000 Parks and Rec Improvement Fund, which covered that extra cost for the painting of the pool that we didn't allocate at the beginning of the year, which council already approved. Then we have in the enterprise funds, again, water fund, we've got the bottleneck elimination, which was $486,000 of that $495,000. We did not appropriate all that originally because we weren't sure how the project was going to be funded, if it was going to happen this year, if some of it was going to happen next year. So we've got that being appropriated in full, and we are also receiving that money back in. We should get all of the distributions from OWDA by the end of the year, so that will be that will zero that out. We also have in water treatment $52,000, which will cover the additional engineering for 2015 for the water plant. We had only appropriated, I think, $225,000, and we ended up spending a little bit more this year than what we thought. We knew what the total costs were going to be. We just didn't know how those were going to play out in 15 and 16, so that's going to cover that. And then in the sewer fund, we had done some refunds out of our guaranteed deposits. So that was just to cover for that. So the majority of the $977,000 are coming from the OPWC loop completion grant and then from the bottleneck elimination projects. But we did receive funding for both of those. So.
Okay. Thank you. Any comments or questions from council?
Melissa, I just wanted to clarify. It's more of a technical question. With the $3,300 that came in from the Community Foundation for the HRC Miller Fellow, how is that accounted for?
Well, what we have to do is, I have to report to the county anything that we expect to bring in, so that comes in via estimated resources, which I'm gonna, that doesn't have to come before council.
Right.
So I have to submit one of those as I'm doing this. So we receipted it in on one end, but since we had to refund them that money, we had to have it appropriated out.
So we have to take it in and then we appropriate it?
Yep.
Okay. But I guess I also just wanted to clarify that that was, you know, all from a grant.
Yeah, a lot of the supplemental appropriations on here really have like a zero impact in terms of our budget because we were receipting money in. It's just, we don't see that side of it with this particular document.
Okay, thanks.
This is a, it's an emergency and it will go into effect immediately, so I will open the public hearing for comment. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Asklund?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes. Next is our budget ordinance, 2015-27. And council, do we want to read this incomplete or can we just read it in by title only? Title only, Judy?
You got it. This is the 2016 annual appropriations and declaring an emergency for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio.
Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, Melissa?
Okay, so this is the budget that we have been talking about for the last couple of months. The only thing that council had requested as a result of the first reading was that they had the actual finalized budget worksheet that tied in so that all of the departments are listed, all of the main areas of expenditure within those departments are listed so that they could review that and ensure that everything tied in with the ordinance. So I did supply that final version of the budget as well as I think that the capital budget was attached to that. I hope it was. I'm not 100% positive if that tied into that main PDF or not.
Yes,
yep. It's
there. Yeah, it is.
But all of those figures were incorporated into that main 19-page budget that you guys have, so. And
Melissa,
none of that changed.
Would you review the numbers that are just the main numbers, the main sections?
Yeah, the totals.
Yeah, we have out of the general fund appropriating $3,306,664. We have out of the special revenue funds a total of $1,328,730. We have out of the capital project funds $42,100. And then we have out of the enterprise fund $6,428,322. For a grand total appropriations out of all funds, $11,105,816.
Very good. Council, questions, comments? And I think we told you at the last meeting that this was a very painless and pleasant budget process, and we appreciate your how well you've put this together and the ease of reading the documents.
Mm-hmm. Thank you all.
This is a public hearing. It's the second reading. I will open the floor for comments from the public. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table for a vote.
Yes, McQueen.
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Asklund?
Yep.
Winthrop?
Yes. Now, definitely the rest of these that are all the Planning Commission ordinances, we will read in by title only.
Got it. So this is ordinance 2015-28, repealing old section 1282.05, non-conforming lots of record of chapter 1282, non-conforming uses, buildings, and lots of title 4, zoning of part 12, planning and zoning of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1282.05, non-conforming lots of record.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Patty?
This is the text amendment that was recommended by the Planning Commission, and it has to do with interior lot lines on adjacent lots that are owned by the same owner. It's simply for the purposes of the zoning code, allows those individual non-conforming lots to be considered as one larger lot as long as they are adjacent and are owned by the same owner.
Any questions or comments from council? This is the second reading. I will open the public hearing for comment from the public.
Oh, I do have one comment.
Oh, hold on. Do we have any public comment? Okay, seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Jerry?
I noticed again, and it seems like it's only in one document that my last name keeps getting spelled wrong.
Oh.
And I don't know if that's going to create problems in the future.
It's right on this one.
Yeah.
On the one that you officially signed?
No, it's
the one that
I've got it correctly. When it comes right from one of the solicitors, I always get your name wrong, and I usually catch it.
Okay.
But I will send a memo.
Would you please call the roll, Judy?
Yes. McQueen?
Yes.
Asklund?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes. 2015-30.
Oh,
2015-29.
Oh, yeah.
-29.
Sorry,
Yes.
I know they do tend to sign the same after. This is repealing old section 1260.04 uses of chapter 1260 general provisions of title 4 zoning of part 12 planning and zoning of the codified ordinances of the village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1260.04 uses.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty.
This one has to do with the fact that home occupations were not included in zone RC, I believe it was. They were permitted in zones RA and RB, which are both residential zones, but not in RC, which is also a residential zone. It is our belief and Planning Commission's belief that that is simply an oversight and that it was to be included in all three zones, and therefore it is this text amendment includes it in all home occupations in all three zones.
Which that's not this one.
This one is the driveways.
No, this one is the size of the accessory structure,
20,
isn't it?
No.
Yeah. 29, right?
Yeah.
29, yes. Accessory structure.
Oh, 29 is okay.
And residential driveways.
Sorry, I'm getting my text amendments confused. The question, this is the one that was not voted on by council.
No, it was the other one. It was 31.
The accessory structure one was the one that was
31.
Okay.
No, because my question was not about the accessory structure, it was about accessory dwelling.
Correct.
And which is included in 31.
Yeah. The one you just described is 31.
Okay.
So, 29 is the one that involves accessory structures being too limiting on property owners.
But they are connected. This is what McQueen asked, whether the approval of ordinance 2015-29 would mean that the section on the accessory dwelling unit size would need to be changed in ordinance 2015-31. If this is not the case, McQueen stated that she would like to know why a dwelling unit should be differentiated from an accessory structure for size regulation.
Do you want me to do the explanation of that now, or do you want me to explain?
Yeah, do it now.
Okay.
Yes.
So what this one did was change the size then of the permitted accessory structures from, I believe it was 40% of the maximum of the livable space to a maximum of 750 square feet, and it changed it to 66% of the living space and a maximum of 800 square feet. The question was brought as to whether this also applied to accessory dwellings and why it wasn't consistent. Mm-hmm. The only explanation that I was given is that they, at the time, were only considering accessory structures such as garages and sheds, and they did not publicly present at a meeting the possibility of making it consistent with the square footage of accessory dwellings. So the two choices that council will have in order to make them consistent, if that's what you want to do, you can either pass this as it is written and then direct the Planning Commission to please consider publicly making the permitted square footage of accessory dwellings consistent with this, or you can reject this and send it back to the Planning Commission for consideration with that same direction. But because it was never heard publicly for accessory dwellings, it cannot be changed and amended at this time.
Well, my understanding of the word accessory building and structure would include accessory dwelling.
But they're considered separately under the zoning code, and that's why they were considering the one section that had to do with accessory structures such as sheds and garages that did not include dwelling units. They were considering that section as opposed to including the section that included accessory dwellings.
Okay, well,
I think it should be the same.
If as the 29 is written, that the accessory structures, excluding dwelling, has been increased in size, the option to increase in size, I believe that accessory dwelling should have that same increase. So I would not support these changes unless that's done.
The count, if that's the case, then that's what council wants, and you would have to reject them and send them back to Planning Commission for them to consider making it consistent between accessory buildings and accessory dwelling units.
I agree with Mary Ann. I think that there are so many accessory structures in Yellow Springs that are converted to dwellings. You know, they're really the only thing that, you know, a shed, somebody could even convert a shed. You could put insulation in it and services, and it could become an accessory dwelling unit relatively easily. So I agree with Mary Ann. I think they should be considered,
you know, or
together.
Why should you be able to have a shed that's bigger than a...
I think, you know, we just didn't pay attention to the fact that these are in two separate places, and it says two different things, and we were looking at different things, and nobody noticed.
So there wasn't any other sort of rationale?
No,
okay.
So are we saying, though, that you should... Are we giving Planning Commission direction that we should make them the same, basically call it an accessory structure, whether it be dwelling or not?
What you would need to do is to ask them to look at making it consistent.
Yeah, I would keep it. I mean, I don't think we want to try to smash them together because there's just too many things that apply only when there's people living in them. And so you have to handle them. You do have to handle them slightly differently in terms of having different sections on them. But they should be consistent.
Okay. So just to understand, we should then reject both of these, 29 and 31, if we agree with that?
Yes, I would.
Okay.
We have to, unfortunately.
We still have to have a public hearing, right?
Right.
Yeah. I will open the public hearing.
Sorry.
Okay. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table for a vote.
Sims.
No.
Asklund.
No.
Hausch.
No.
McQueen.
No.
Quintrow.
No. Next is 2015-30.
All right, this is repealing old section 1266.05, permitted signs of chapter 1266 signs of Title IV zoning of Part 12, planning and zoning of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1266.05, permitted signs.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second. Okay, Patty?
When this came before council, before, the question was on type A ground signs and the sectional divisions that are at the top of that in color, and why conservation is not under the number as where it is included in the other two, and industrial is not included anywhere except location. If you look at that, under number it says residential and all other signs. And that is the only differentiation that is made on the number of signs. Once you get into the size, there is a differentiation made for conservation and the square footage of a sign that can be used in a conservation district. And when you get into location, there is a further differentiation for industrial. But at the top in the first section, there are two numbers. You can have one in a residential, or you can have one per street footage, front footage. at the, in all other districts, and that's why it is listed the way it is.
Okay. Any other questions or comments from council? I'll open the public hearing for comments or questions from citizens. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Asklund.
Yep.
McQueen.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes. Finally, 2015, well, finally for zoning, 2015-31.
This is repealing old section 1262.08, specific requirements of chapter 1262, conditional use requirements of Title IV zoning, of Part 12, planning and zoning of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1262.08, specific requirements.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
So Patty, this is the companion to the other one?
This is the companion to the other one, and this is the one that allows for the home occupations in accessory dwelling units as a conditional use in all three zones.
But do we have an issue with the accessory dwelling size in this one?
Not in this one.
Not in this one, okay.
Wait,
we're on 31.
No, 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 no.
Aren't we on 31?
31?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, yeah, this is the one that does have the
this
size.
This is the one, if we're going to make the other one bigger, then this one needs to be bigger too. And this one has not been changed. This one still says the same old numbers as the last.
Oh, it
That's
does.
What we just changed. That's the whole point. It's
on the
this
fifth
one
page.
That needs to change.
Down near the bottom.
I understood we didn't want to change the other one until this one was consistent. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Is it under residential D?
So I will, I'll open the public hearing for comments or questions. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you call the roll?
Yes. Hausch.
No.
Sims.
No.
Asklund.
No.
McQueen.
No.
Wintrow.
No. Next is 2015-32.
This is repealing section 606.05 of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 606.05.
Okay, Patty, would you, need a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty, would you explain this one?
This is the ordinance that gives our police department the authority to enforce all village, state, and federal laws on our properties that are outside the municipal limits of the village. This includes the Sutton Farm, the water plant, and Ellis Park.
Okay.
Are the three specific locations that we're talking about.
Okay, any comments or questions from council? Judy, would you please call the roll?
It's an ordinance. Did you open a public hearing?
It's the first reading. We're going to do two readings.
Okay.
Okay. McQueen?
Yes.
Asklund?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next is 2015-33.
This is repealing section 206.01 of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs and enacting new section 206.01.
Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, this is an ordinance that increases the purchasing capabilities of the village manager from $15,000 to $30,000 without getting direct council approval of the expenditure. The maximum allowed by the state of Ohio is $50,000. And as I understand, most communities actually give their managers leeway up to that $50,000, but Patty was satisfied with $30,000, so we thought we would keep it at that.
And we have not changed it
in years.
In many, many years.
Right.
And so there's just things that can go wrong that it's difficult if the manager can't kind of immediately purchase them without a big public process. So she still has, there's still very many limitations on what the manager can do, and there's signature requirements and all kinds of things. Could you maybe, so that citizens understand that, what are sort of the ways that the manager's power is limited, even though you'll have this slightly increased purchasing power?
Well, I'm still limited by what's available in the budget that has been approved by council. I'm still limited by, even if I enter a requisition, Melissa still has to approve it, and then I have to approve it again. There are still if it is a contract that is not an emergency and has to be let by a public notice, I still have to do that, which then has to be approved by council. So there are many things that still limit my ability to spend money.
Okay. Any other comments or questions? This is only a first reading. We'll have the public hearing at the next meeting. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Asklund.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes. Resolution 2015-53.
This is adjusting rates of pay for village employees.
The next one is actually village manager.
Oh, and sorry, I had it sitting separately awaiting your approval. Sitting out, and I did not title it, but this is adjusting the rate of pay for the village manager.
And can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second. And we actually went into executive session before at the beginning of the meeting, and for the purpose of reviewing with Patty, and it was Patty's, the process was very positive. We heard from village staff, village supervisors. We heard from our solicitor. All of council provided an evaluation, as did Patty provide a self-evaluation, and all were positive, all were in alignment, and we've just been incredibly happy with the stability that Patty has brought, with the ease of working with citizens, the way she's involved herself in the community, working with council in a very respectful way, and working with staff in a very respectful way. So council expressed deep appreciation to Patty for the work she's done in the past 18 months. Any other comments or that you'd like to add?
I think that really sums it up. You know, again, when we look at sort of where we were and where we are now, striving towards balancing a budget, having a cohesive team, positive leadership, it's exactly what I hoped for when I joined council. So I'm incredibly happy. And obviously, we hired Patty because she's a doer.
Thank you.
And right, the projects, I think that's somewhat at the top of the list when you look at the number of projects that have been completed in the past 18 months and the projects that we still have on the books for the next year and a half with the water plant. It's exciting, and we're actually getting a lot done right now.
And I would also say that Patty is a pretty humble person. She generally, when we praise her for things that have gotten done, if anybody had any role in it, she immediately brings their role to our attention and make sure that they get the credit for the work they did. So she does not hog the limelight by any means. She's a very even-keeled person and is extremely good about getting back to you if you have a question. At least that's been my experience, and many citizens have contacted me to say she's been very, very responsive to citizens' concerns. So I'm very, very pleased. Having gone through many village managers in my time, I'm pleased at the way we've been able to, at the way Patty has stepped into this position.
Maybe people don't know that Patty also walked 60 miles in 3 days. How long ago? A couple weeks ago?
The weekend before Thanksgiving, yes.
And I think it's a good time to mention also that, I mean, it was no accident that this has been successful. It was due to a very complete hiring process. And so I wanted to be on record that that's a very important component moving forward to make sure that we are properly vetting the folks that we hire to make sure that we have that longevity.
Mm-hmm. And hearing from citizens was really important. And there was lots of opportunity for citizens to engage with our candidates. And we think you guys helped us do a great job in hiring Patty.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was quite exhaustive. I said exhaustive, not exhausting.
No, it was exhausting for us. Any comments from citizens? Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to the table. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Now we're at 2015-55. Judy?
And this one is adjusting rates of pay for village employees.
Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. And I will turn this over to Patty.
It is our normal course of action when council is considering a rate increase or a pay increase for the employees to look around and see what other municipalities in our area are doing. You'll find in your packets a brief recap of what we found this year. Our normal practice, according to CERB, most wage increases for 2016 in this area are between 1.5 and 2.5%. I detail there what Xenia, Fairborn, and Bellbrook are all giving. The average for most of these is 2% or higher, and so it is Melissa and my recommendation that council approve a 2% increase for our affected employees, and that amount has been included in the 2016 budget.
Any comments or questions, council? Comments or questions from citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
2015-59.
Yes.
Title only.
The official question and issue ballot for the general election March 15th, 2015, proposed levy, tax levy renewal.
Motion, please.
So moved.
Second.
I'm going to let Judy address this, but it's my understanding that there was an irregularity with the language from the last resolution, so we still had time to do the new resolution. Is that correct, Judy?
We do, just. And this just flew right on by the Board of Elections, and they did not have an issue with it, but the auditor's office noted that the word increase was used at two different points in the resolution for the one we passed initially, and they felt it would be clearer if that were corrected, and the renewal was put in its stead, and so that has been done. They've vetted it, and this should pass right on through.
Thank you.
Because it is not, in fact, an increase. It's, it is simply
right,
a renewal
of the same amount.
Levy, correct.
Council, any comments or questions? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. And then, the one that's not on here is the 2015-60. Marianne, would you like this to be read in full?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
Judy, would you read this?
Unless you would like to, Marianne?
Marianne, do you want to read it?
No. This is welcoming Syrian refugees to the village of Yellow Springs. Whereas Yellow Springs Village Council commends President Obama's commitment to welcome at least 10,000 Syrian refugees into the United States. And whereas Yellow Springs has a history of taking in refugees and attracting immigrants and places high value on being a welcoming community. And whereas we wish to join with the 18 mayors of major U.S. cities, including Ann Whaley of Dayton, who have acknowledged in a letter to President Obama that our community has, quote, been transformed by the skills and spirit of those who come to us from around the world, end quote. And we see firsthand the myriad ways in which immigrants and refugees make our community stronger economically, socially, and culturally. And whereas the political situation in Syria has led to the largest refugee crisis since World War II, now therefore Council for the Village of Yellow Springs hereby resolves that. Section 1, Council for the Village of Yellow Springs joins the mayors and elected representatives of cities across the nation in extending our well wishes to any local efforts to welcome Syrian refugees to our community. Section 2, Council hereby charges the Human Relations Commission to coordinate with any such efforts currently underway.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second. Marianne, would you?
And actually, I think it was Lori who initially suggested this, I think.
Well, several people had come up to me and said council should do something. I think particularly after Governor Kasich basically said refugees are not welcome in this state. I felt there are times when the council could get bogged down in taking a stand on every federal or national issue, and I don't think that that's something council should do, because there are many things we could comment on in the world. But this one, with the governor saying effectively we don't want you, and it kind of including us in that umbrella, it seemed to me that it's kind of important to say we disagree with that stance. Mm-hmm. So that was why, especially when several community members came up to me and said we'd like council to do something, and they came up to me independently, not as a group, I felt like this does seem like something we should actually weigh in on and take a, make a statement on, joining with lots of other municipalities that have made similar statements.
I agree. I appreciate it. There was some discussion on Facebook and you know, I mean, the idea of actually bringing Syrian refugees here, I don't think that's our role, but certainly anything we could do to support if somebody was able to do that. So, but I agree. I like the language of this resolution, simply stating our support for welcoming them.
And we did discuss it at HRC, and HRC definitely supports this resolution and taking some role in that.
Thank okay. you.
Great.
Great.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Folks, I would like to, Pete Williams is here from the Department of Development. I don't think he'll really take a long time. I would like, since we, I believe the next discussion may take a little longer, I would like that we would move into having Pete come up and present what he would like to present. Okay. Mm-hmm. Pete, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mrs. Intro.
Don't use that, Mrs. Yes.
That's Mrs. Wintrow, you.
President Wintrow.
President Wintrow, thank you so much for inviting me here tonight, Council, Village Manager. Thank you so much. My name is Pete Williams. I'm the Director of Development for Greene County. My offices are located at 61 Greene Street, Xenia, Ohio, 45385. Tonight I wanted to update the Village Council on a project that I've been working on in conjunction with the Village Manager and some other key folks in the development department at Greene County and some folks at the Yellow Springs Chamber, one of whom is here with us. There's a company interested in a property at 888 Dayton Street that most of you know is the Antioch Publishing Building. And the company is considering purchasing the property and moving their business to 888 Dayton Street and bringing 90 jobs in the first 12 months and 120 jobs in the first 36 months. This company is a printing, marketing, distribution, and logistics company out of Dayton. They're called Dayton Mailing Services. They've been around for 30 years, and they've simply outgrown the space that they occupy in downtown Dayton. They've gone through an exhaustive search through the city of Dayton and Montgomery County for a suitable facility, and we've been in close contact with the folks at the city of Dayton and the folks at Montgomery County trying to help them find a spot there. That not being able to be done, they've really grown keen to the property at 888 Dayton Street because it's a single floor facility. It has great infrastructure for the type of business that they run. In addition to purchasing the building pending, they would also like to expand the facility by do a $1.5 million expansion to the facility. As I said, and move the 76 current jobs they have here right away, add another 16 jobs in the first year, and add another 30 jobs after that in the 24 months to follow. So we're looking at a projected payroll increase in the first year of about $3.2 million into the village, with another $600,000 or so to follow after that. The reason I'm here updating you is because they requested use of the Ohio Enterprise Zone program. As most of you know, the Ohio Enterprise Zone program is a tax abatement program that would essentially abate a portion of the new value generated on an expansion of a property for a term. What Dayton Mailing Services is looking to do, as I mentioned, was a $1.5 million expansion of the property at 888 Dayton Street. That's a physical expansion of the facility. They're also going to be moving all their machinery equipment, all their infrastructure, all their inventory there. But that will, in a sense, increase the property value by $1.5 million. What they've asked us to do through the Ohio Enterprise Zone, and Greene County is the administrator of the Ohio Enterprise Zone in the county's villages and townships, is to offer a tax abatement for a period of 10 years. Based on the amount of jobs they're moving to Yellow Springs, based on the new payroll they'll be bringing with them, based on the infrastructure investment they'll be making and the purchase of the facility, we're recommending a 75% abatement of new property tax value for a period of 10 years. Now, currently, the property at 888 Dayton Street is valued at around $700,000 on the auditor's tax rolls. And the six affected political subdivisions collect a little under $20,000 a year off of that building. With this projected expansion, we would be looking at a new pot of over $40,000 in new tax revenue that could be generated. What we would then propose is of that $40,000 in new money and new taxable value generated to, here, let me remove my keys. Watch that car, see what I'm doing, but I don't want to stop. restores his nice carpet. Of that $40,000 in new tax generated value, we would offer for the company an abatement of $30,000 worth of that for a period of 10 years, bringing $10,000 in new property tax revenue to the 6 affected political subdivisions, the village, the county, the schools, the library, the public health district, and I think the village has two, Miami Township. So what I would like to do is come back in 2 weeks after I've been able to talk with Patty and the village solicitor about the terms of the agreement. It's pretty boilerplate on the agreement side, but I want to make sure that everyone here is okay with this from the standpoint of understanding the program. I'm not asking you to take a vote tonight, obviously, but it's important for you guys to know that I've met with the school district along with Karen and with Brian. We sat down with the superintendent, and I know that he's already spoken to some of his board members because I ran into Dr. Creighton at a meeting a few days ago. And the school district, by law, is required to be notified of the abatement. They don't get an affirmative vote, but they're allowed to comment. Because we're not asking for more than 75% of the value to be abated, they don't get an up or down vote, but they are encouraged to provide comment to you folks. But the feedback from the school district was very positive at our first meeting. Because of the number of jobs we're bringing into the village, and because of the investment that this company is willing to make, and as I mentioned, they're hoping to purchase the building. That sale's pending, a lot of other details that we're working out right now at the county level. But I wanted to bring this up to you guys tonight and see if there's any questions you had tonight about the program. Again, I don't expect you guys to have to do a deep dive into the terms of this right now, but I wanted to give you guys as much information as I could at this update and then come back on the 21st and ask the village manager is comfortable asking for a vote at that time.
And Pete, they do have these two pieces.
Fantastic.
Of information. So if you want to reference these or if council has any questions about them.
Where were they?
They should have been at your seats. Oh. Judy, did you put them?
No.
Oh, okay.
My bad.
Okay.
What's on those sheets?
One of them is a spreadsheet that shows the current tax structure.
Current tax structure on the right, and then with the expansion on the left.
And I just want to be clear that the abatement that Pete is talking about is on the expansion. The property, as it sits now, the full taxation value would still be there on that property. The abatement is only on the $1.5 million expansion.
Correct.
And I think there's already been significant investment in that building. So when with the tenants that are already there, plans are for the tenants to be able to stay for a period of time, and they will be bringing their equipment. So they will be increasing the value of that existing structure. So we will be in the schools, all of the taxing entities will be realizing an increase in property taxes from the existing building. And we will be getting some increase in property taxes, a 25% increase in property taxes from the addition. We will be getting 100% of the income tax from those employees. And Pete said it was a $3.5 million payroll.
Right.
The thing I am particularly excited about is that chances are those employees that they're moving for the first part of the move are going to be coming from the region, probably not locally, but they're going to be hiring around 40 people that will be prime jobs for villagers. And for the schools, the added bonus is that the schools only get income tax if you live and work in Yellow Springs, but where the hope is that they will be hiring locally as much as possible so that the schools will see a double benefit just as we will.
I have a question, not about the program, but you said the current tenants, which are now two doctor's offices that have recently mm-hmm. moved in, and also
Brewery has some.
Well, anyway, you said they would be able to stay there for a time.
Well, those terms will be negotiated with the property owner.
Mm-hmm. That's the plan currently.
And they are aware. All of the tenants are aware of.
The implication to me is that at some point they will be asked to leave. Am I reading that incorrectly?
We don't know. It will depend upon their expansion plans. I think that the positive aspect is that we've got a completely filled building with the opportunity to find places for
some significant additional tenants to have office space. So this is nothing but a win-win situation.
Has the Economic Sustainability Commission, are they going to be weighing in on this?
Well, our first official meeting is in January.
And this has to be done prior to that.
What is the, can you tell me a little bit about these jobs? What kind of education are they likely to require, or what kind of pay range are we talking about?
There's going to be a pretty good mix between folks that could essentially walk in out of high school, mm-hmm. to work for DMS, and there's also a large need for them to expand their sales and their executive side of the office as well. So the average salary of these expansion jobs is around $31,000, but the company did stress to us that that's a range, that there could be some $12 an hour. There also could be some $25 to $30 an hour in that mix, mm-hmm. of folks that they need to hire.
But so they'd be mostly hourly?
Well, I just referenced, mm-hmm. that as, mm-hmm. a, you know, anywhere from, mm-hmm. From maybe $24,000 a year up to, you know, $50,000 or $60,000 a year based on their need. Now, they will have a larger need for warehouse work. That's why the 888 Dayton Street building was so attractive to them, because it's single floor, it's got tall ceilings. It was made for a paper company, yeah. And a large amount of what DMS does currently is manufacturing distribution of paper products, but they are diversifying into 3D printing. They're diversifying. They have a large marketing wing now, and mm-hmm. that's the part of the business they want to grow. And I know that the office side of the ANIAC Publishing Building is attracted to them to be able to grow that side of their business. So I think there's an opportunity for people who maybe have just finished high school to find work there, and there's also a chance for designers and marketing folks as well, in addition to salespeople and people that do the books. Mm-hmm. So I feel like this is a full-service company. This is a mm-hmm. this is a company with a regional footprint, a global distribution network that they work within, and they want a place where they can grow.
Paper products for what, and how can we find out more about the company? I mean,
look on their website.
So what's the name of the company?
The company is Dayton Mailing Services, and the website is daytonmailing.com. It's locally owned. The current owner is second generation owner of the company. She's the daughter of the founder.
I am a little bit, I don't see any smiles on the faces at this table, and I'm curious as to why. This is an opportunity that I honestly never thought would come to Yellow Springs. I am practically near tears with the possibilities, and I'm very disappointed to not feel that same level of excitement from my fellow council members.
Well, I mean, this is a big deal, and so I think given that it's a big deal, we need to look at it and see what it is. I mean, mm-hmm. we have some power. I mean, I'm fine with the enterprise zone concept, but mm-hmm. I'd like to know more about the company, and I do have some concerns that there are businesses there now that will have to leave, and then, you know, what will they do? And they've presumably put in money, and so I just want to know more about it.
The terms of the leases are not, I'm not privy to those currently.
No, I mean, I want to know more about this particular company. What it does?
Well,
it mails thing, but like, what does it mail?
I don't think they mail pornography.
No, they do large mailings for companies that do marketing pieces. They do marketing for companies.
They're getting into more electronic marketing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're getting into digital marketing. They want to beef up their marketing side of the office as well, which I think is mm-hmm. great for a place like Yellow Springs, because they need creative folks with design backgrounds to work there, in addition to people who maybe are just looking for warehouse work, in addition to folks who are looking for work in an office setting. So I would encourage you to check out the website. This is a certified minority business enterprise, and it's also it's a women-owned business as well. So I've only gotten to know the owner, Christine Souter, a little bit, but she's a fourth generation Daytonian and really cares about the region. these guys could go anywhere. They really could. As I mentioned, they're a regional company with a global footprint, and they also do a lot of election materials. People who need 1,000-yard signs and things like that, they've become very good at that side of the business as well. So there's nothing to prevent them, except for their ties to the region, from being in Columbus, from being in Memphis at the FedEx hub. This is really a company that could go anywhere.
Mm-hmm. And to Karen's comment, and I kind of looked at the audience too, you know, it's a surprise.
That's just it.
You know, so much so that, you know, I'm somewhat speechless, but, you know, a lot of effort has been gone into the past to try to get a small medium-sized company in, and it sounds like we have kind of crossed that hurdle, and companies are willing to come to Yellow Springs. So, you know, to me, like I say, it's I'm kind of speechless, but, you know, I'm hoping that all this can be worked out, because we do need a new business here in Yellow Springs with the potential of hiring people that live here in Yellow Springs so they don't have to leave and go elsewhere. So it's going to take a little time for it to settle in, but I'm kind of speechless, but excited.
You're smiling now.
Well, and this, I'm looking at their website, and it says they have national and international mailing services, letter shop services, digital printing, data services. They are your one-stop shop for all your mailing and full-service printing needs from design to distribution. So that's just with a glance at the website.
It's essentially the same business that Antioch Publishing was in. They're doing some printing, but moving into digital. Mm-hmm. So I find it pretty interesting that we're replacing one printing company with another.
And what the website doesn't say is that there's the DMS is also the parent company for two other companies. One is a marketing company, and one is a logistics company that they run out of the same shop because of the expertise that they've gained through 3 decades of running this company. Mm-hmm. And Mr. Sims, as you said, this has kind of come as a shock, and it's come very fast. But I would speak for Karen for a minute. I think it's taken us years and years to become an overnight success with this building, because I can't tell you how many folks we've walked through that and how many times we've pushed it out to folks and tried to get people interested and played and made sure that they knew about everything that we had to offer as a region and as a village. And we knew it was going to, because of the type of building it was and the type of previous use that it had, we knew it was going to take a unique end user, but I knew we'd find them eventually.
Right. This is that end user.
This is that.
Well, I do want to say a couple other things. I am super excited, and I'm not smiling tonight because of other issues that are more serious, but I do think, I will mention that the schools weren't just happy about it, they were thrilled. Mm-hmm. And we did not have these details until now, because, you know, one of the issues is until that is settled, it could not be shared. Karen and I were brought in because two council members can participate in a meeting that's not public to at least hear about some of the background. But we didn't even know the details about the company or anything until tonight.
That was we were only given the clear to discuss the company publicly today.
Right. And again, that's because certain things need to be negotiated beforehand. But to Karen's point, I would expect some of the people in the room to be very excited, because the big push related to the CBE is let's focus on infill, and that's exactly mm-hmm. what we're doing. Mm-hmm. So we're bringing jobs, we're using an existing space, we have opportunities to develop new spaces, so a nice medical office building. There's a lot of great stuff going on.
And Patty, did I emailed you a copy of their Enterprise Zone application?
You did not.
Okay, I'll leave this with you today for you to make sure that the council members can see. The Dayton Mailing Services is prepared to make an investment in the village of just south of $7.75 million, the total project, once they get everything moved here, all the machinery equipment they're going to bring, the infrastructure improvements they're making to the current building, and the expansion they're planning for the new part of the building. In addition to purchasing, pending, let me make sure I say pending purchasing, They're looking at other sites in the region, but we really feel that this building is for them. So, but again, I wanted to come tonight to get you guys acquainted with the program. I've been with the county for about 4 years. I've yet to do an enterprise zone in the village, and the places I have done them, I like to make sure that people have a level of comfort with how the program works. It's always been important, and I think this speaks for a lot of the communities in Greene County, it's always been important to the elected officials that we have talked to the schools early. We did that in this case. We sat down with the superintendent last week, and I've been able to follow up with him, as I mentioned, and members of the school board, to make sure that they understood what this meant and what they'd be gaining with this investment coming to the village, and what they would be going without for a period of 10 years. And then year 11, 100% of the increased value goes to all six political subdivisions.
Thank you, Pete.
All right.
Thanks, Pete.
Yeah, so I think my only comment was just that when I don't have anything in writing and I am hit with something new, I can't respond immediately. And the other thing is, when somebody comes in and everything sounds really good, it's just really important for me to have some time to do at least a little bit of due diligence.
Absolutely.
And I understand. I had literally not one clue that any of this was going on. So yeah, it's an awful lot for me to just. And so I'm really glad that you're happy, and I'm glad that the school is happy. I still, you know, and I'm especially, I'd like to know more about the certified. For some reason, my Wi-Fi is not working at all, so I can't. I'd like to know more about the family that owns it, the certified minority-owned, woman-owned business.
Absolutely.
Sounds very good. I'm pleased to hear that there would be jobs for people of a variety of educational backgrounds. It's just, it's very hard for governments who are, we're used to having everything in writing and having to be very transparent. And the problem with capitalism is it doesn't operate that way. Mm. It doesn't like transparency.
And so that's why I wanted to come tonight and give you guys this.
Yeah, so
this
I just wanted to make sure people are clear that it's not,
And I will flood you with paperwork.
Personal.
<next few weeks. laughs>
Spoken like a true development guy, Pete.
Yes. Yeah. But Dade Mailing Services carries three certifications. They're certified women business enterprise, they're certified minority business enterprise, and they are certified women-owned small business.
It's very exciting.
And that's featured prominently on the front page of their website.
It seems like something that we should definitely move forward with, getting more information so that we can make a good decision about this. And but it seems on the surface, from your presentation, it sounds like it's something for that's very exciting.
And the way that the enterprise zone works is that if there's, you know, we talk about transparency, making sure if it sounds too good to be true, is it really so?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The enterprise zone agreement is basically a 10-year contract between the county and the village on one side and the business on the other side. They have to report every year. Every year they have to show us that they're meeting the job numbers they said they would, they're meeting the payroll they said they would, and the infrastructure investment they said they were going to make has been made. Mm-hmm. If at any point over the year 1, year 5, year 7, they don't hit those numbers, we have every right to end the agreement right then. Mm. And they basically get that every year that they meet those numbers, we renew it for 1 year. Okay. So this is a 10-year renewable. At the end of 10 years, it extinguishes. But every year they have to come before the Tax Incentive Review Council, which I chair for the county. And right now we have 5 active enterprise zones, and every year those businesses come to us and they present to us their payroll to make and those numbers to ensure that they have met those numbers, that we renew it for another year. Okay. So you're not signing it away. See you in 2026.
Well, that's very helpful to hear. Yeah. Thank
yes,
you.
Yes, absolutely. That's why I want to make sure that you guys are comfortable with the program as we talk about it.
Right. And I do want council to understand that we were under a cloak of confidentiality because of the building not
the
having
negotiations for the sale,
and so that was why council was not informed. And as Pete said, we just today were told we would.
Yeah,
be
I didn't
able
tell
to
my bosses
this.
Till today either.
And so
imagine how they felt.
And so you each have one of Pete's cards now, and I'm sure that if you have any questions at all, that he would be more than happy to answer them.
Okay. Absolutely. So. So with that, I'll let you guys continue with your meeting. If there's no further questions at this time, but again, I'm very happy.
Judith, good if people have a chance.
I just want to register as a citizen that this sounds very exciting. I want to get rid of that sort of narrative about how we're anti-business. I don't think that's true. This sounds really exciting, and I appreciate what Lori said, that, you know, it's something we have to be looking at carefully. We need to have good information, but it sounds excellent, so.
Thanks, Judith.
The work has been done.
Thanks, Judith.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions from citizens while Pete's still here? Okay, thanks a lot, Pete.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, it's very exciting, actually.
Thank you, guys. I mean, that's what I was, it was more not about, you know, I understand wanting to understand the enterprise zone. I think it was more about this idea of, oh my God, there's a company coming with that many jobs. I expected,
right.
Expected a reaction.
No, I.
That's okay.
Too much information all at once.
I think what you got was stunned as opposed to, yay!
Okay, okay, so. I guess, yeah, I've had time to let it sink in. So, okay. Let's move on to the last, we'll get back to business, move back to the last resolution, 2015-54, and Judy, let's read this in full.
All right, this is authorization to withdraw from the Greene County Agencies for Combined Enforcement, aka the ACE Task Force. Whereas the Village of Yellow Springs Council convened forums and public hearings to discuss the Village's continued participation in the Greene County Agencies for Combined Enforcement, commonly referred to as the ACE Task Force. And whereas the Village Council has discussed the benefits and the costs of the Village's continued participation in the ACE Task Force, including the opinions of Village staff and the Village Chief of Police. And whereas the Village Council has weighed and considered public comments, the opinions of Village staff, the Police Department, the 2015 Vision for Local Policing, and the financial considerations of the Village's continued participation in the ACE Task Force. Whereas the Village Council has weighed the possible impact on the overall safety to the Village if the Village withdraws from the ACE Task Force, and whereas Village Council has determined not to continue its participation in the ACE Task Force, now therefore the Council of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio hereby resolves that Section 1, the Village shall withdraw its participation from the Greene County Agencies for Combined Enforcement, ACE Task Force. Section 2, the Village Manager is hereby authorized to send the appropriate written notice to withdraw from the ACE Task Force as soon as is practical.
Can I have a motion, please?
I so move.
Second.
Okay. Council, we spent a lot of time. I know that there's a lot of people here. We've spent a lot of time talking about this. I expect that we each have statements or comments we'd like to make. How would you like, do you have comments about how you would like to see this move forward? I don't know that we need to spend a lot of time. I'd like to hear from people who haven't been heard on this subject in the past, if there is anyone here. What is council's pleasure?
Well, I'd like to hear if there are folks in the audience that haven't had a chance to speak, let them speak, and then we take a few minutes and then we vote.
Marianne?
I would just like to say that assuming that this passes, that what we do as a community next, I don't know if we want to talk about it tonight, but I think it's important.
Definitely go on future right. agenda.
I mean, I've got a statement. I don't know if we're going to go down the table. I know I've got a statement that I want to give. I don't know if the rest of council does or not. But first, we'll open it to comments. I want to start out with people who have comments to make on the subject who haven't been to a meeting and who would like to have their opinion heard. Linda.
I have.
And if you would come up to the
microphone. Yes, I will. This is copies for council. And I have copies for communities, if you're interested. I just thought I'd write out what I was going to present tonight. I'm just going to tell average side if you're passing things that's interested in talking. Which microphone do I speak at?
I don't know. I've never seen that one.
This one?
Yeah.
Okay. My name is Linda Radowski. I live here in the Village. Some of you know already that I work with persons who have severe and chronic mental illness, also drug addiction, who have become homeless. And so I see on a regular basis what drug addiction can do to your life. People tend to lose their families, their jobs, their homes, and hit bottom. So I see things from that perspective mostly. I didn't come to the last meeting, but I did watch it on television, and I was impressed with a lot of good expression from people that came very passionately. I have a couple quick questions just to throw out, because in my field, there's a lot of decrease in monies for prevention, because you can't prove you're preventing anything. And I think the task force issue is kind of the same thing, that, you know, some passionate arguments were made, it's a really bad problem, and I totally agree it's a terrible problem. So therefore, is the task force working because it's a terrible problem? Well, you know, what we need to look at is it preventing more issues? You know, we need to know that in a way more. Like, if there wasn't a task force, if there was, you know, 100 issues, would there have been 150 issues or 200 issues? You know, we can't say if it's going to prevent. We can't. There's nothing that's going to say that. The other question is, if they remove or withdraw, will that send a signal to persons who are dealing that it's easy game? That worries me. I'm so protective of my persons I assist. I that worries me. If in fact it does help, that worries me. The other area is, of course, people who use. So in my opinion, I think the village is very strong in telling the police this is the way we want to do it, because it's a philosophical reason, and I get it, but I also feel that they know what they're doing a lot of time, and we need to say, if we're going to say, don't do it the way you think it needs to be done, do it our way. Well, what is our way? And we need to balance it. We need to support. We need to put things in place so we can strengthen people with addictions. I commend Karen for bringing up the branch for TCN. We need to look at it's supply and demand. You know, we need to reduce the demand for it. And it's not just purchasing, it's people in our community who are suffering from addiction. So we need to look at that. How can we strengthen them? How can we make them strong enough that they can be in recovery and they can not be receptive and vulnerable to the person's dealing? Okay, jump forward to my sheet. My sheet is, it was brought up, I can't remember who brought it up, but anyway, they mentioned the new innovative way to handle drug addiction by police. And I did the research, because I haven't heard it spoken yet, and I had already researched, and I thought, I'm going to do research for the council. This is the PAARI, the Police Assisted Addiction and Recovery Initiative, that was started in Gloucester, Massachusetts. You've probably seen the video of the police chief online. So their whole approach is more, hey, come to us, you know, tell us you have a problem, we will not arrest, we will get you in treatment. The whole point is that they get into a national collaboration, and they have a large system of treatment centers, because we know that's an issue. If someone came to you and said, I need help, there's nowhere to go. So they hook up in a network nationally.
And you're at time, so.
Council, I would like to hear more from Linda. Okay. I think she has professional expertise to bear.
So what they do is they decriminalize using. Okay, they want to assist in that area. So what they did was there are two initiative models that you see on the paper that can be used. One is called the Gloucester Angel Initiative Program, and I just put very basic things on here. But what they do is they assign what they call an angel, but they assign someone. When someone walks in the door and says, I need help, they assign someone to them, and they get them through to whatever they need. The other initiative is the Arlington Outreach Initiative, which is another good model. And what they do is they have a public health clinician embedded in the police department. So they have someone there that is looking at these issues from that approach to assist. Currently in Ohio, there are two police departments who are now partnering with this initiative. Blendon Township, which is in Westerville, just joined. And Lodi, I think it's called, Police Department in Medina, up towards Akron.
It's on the way to Cleveland.
Yep.
What's that?
It's on the way to Cleveland, right outside of Cleveland.
Okay. They also are a partner, and they're listed on this website. What I recommend is that we look at a region-wide information session where we bring in the people from Massachusetts, we bring in the two Ohio police departments, and we do and we don't just do Yellow Springs. We look at Montgomery County and Clark County, you know, our surrounding counties, because what good is it going to do just to do this in Greene County? And then look, have them come in, talk about what they've done, how you do it, what we need to do, and gather that information together. Finally, as I was looking at this, I thought, you know, we all have legitimate concerns. We all have demographics areas that we're very concerned about. And I really think it'd be important if we just formed a Yellow Springs Safety Commission. I think we should look at fire and police, and I think we should look at what are all the issues that the police more specifically deal with. We've already identified mental health as an issue, alcohol is an issue. We have Black Lives Matters is a hugely important issue. We have, you know, homelessness. So my proposal is that we have a public safety commission, and we have co-representatives. We have not just a professional, but we have someone who is in the trenches, who's been there, who sees it from that angle. And, you know, I'm not getting into specifics how, where, when, but it's not telling the police what to do. It's sitting down and voicing the concerns in the community, and it's working together to understand how to approach those issues. And it's also accessing training, any training that's whatsoever available to community members and to the police themselves. And so I feel like, in closing, we need to, if we're going to say, if our police department is saying we think it's a good idea to be on the task force, and we're saying we know it's not really our area of expertise, but we don't want you to, what are we saying back? And to me, we need to say something, but this is what we're going to do. We're going to make sure you have supports, we're going to make sure you have training, and we're going to make sure we have help for the people that are vulnerable. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Linda. This was very excellent, excellent.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Other comments from folks who have not been at meetings?
Or
haven't commented before? State your name.
My name is Anya. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Like I said, my name is Anya. I grew up in Yellow Springs, and I'm now a mother raising my children here. We are told by ACE Task Force personnel that they only care about big-time dealers, but I know from experience that this is a lie. Just over a decade ago, when YS was new to the task force, I was driving out of town to attend a graduation party with a friend in my passenger seat. On the outskirts of town, a new officer pulled me over and issued a speeding warning. After the warning was given to me, he illegally asked me to step out of my vehicle and barraged me with questions about drugs in my vehicle and on my person, and used a family tragedy in his intimidation tactics. He illegally asked my passenger if he had any drugs. My passenger, terrified, handed the officer a very small amount of marijuana he had procured from his mother. My passenger expressed fear that a drug charge could affect his ability to access financial aid for college. The officer told us, "You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours," and explicitly told us he wanted us to work as informants. We were allowed to leave and attend the graduation party, but in the week that followed, the officer pursued and harassed me. He would flag me down as I drove to and from my two jobs in town, urging me to come to his office at the police station. I contacted an attorney. In court, the officer identified himself as an ACE Task Force officer. Any potential evidence against my friend was dismissed due to the fact that the officer broke legal protocol. This officer intentionally targeted two young, queer, and potentially vulnerable members of the community, just as law enforcement routinely targets working people, people of color, and vulnerable members of the community with little resources. This is appalling and just one of the many incidents here in town alone. I urge council to vote against the task force. Thanks.
Thank you. Anyone else? OK.
council, are we ready to make our own comments and take a vote?
Yeah.
Jerry, who wants to go first? Jerry?
Yeah, I do.
Okay.
Yeah. Number one, I wanted to thank council for delaying their vote at our last meeting. And believe me, these last 2 weeks have really opened up my eyes. Number one, I did have a chance to go to the task force and see what they did and also hear some of the debates that they had. But more importantly, Sunday, I had a chance to watch 60 Minutes. And I don't know how many of you had a chance to see that also, but that was sickening and appalling to me. Having a grandson that has just gone off to college in a out of state and so forth, as a parent, and I got two calls, one from my son-in-law and one from my daughter, wanting to know, was I watching? You know, I guess I'm a little naive, thinking that people always act on the up and up. But again, that program opened my eyes. I may still vote no for leaving the task force, but my reasonings now are very different. And my reasoning is, by leaving the task force, I may lose that vote at the table. I had a long discussion with the chief this morning, and we have a chief that's willing to challenge when he sees things that are wrong and shouldn't be happening. By us leaving, my fear is that, based upon what I've seen and what I've just heard from this young lady, that we may also have a task force that may be a little bit out of control. So for those reasons, I'd rather be on the inside versus being on the outside, wondering what is going on and I don't know about it. The second part about it is, I hate to leave something if I don't have an exit plan and a plan to put in place. So those would be my two reasonings for voting not to stay in the task force. Linda has presented us a plan, and hopefully we'll move on that. But I'm a little nervous right now of leaving a task force that could be out of control.
The 60 Minutes program, because people have talked about the heroin one, but it's
well,
no.
Okay,
what about...
This and I was actually going to reference it.
Yeah, what
it was
and I'll let Karen.
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead. I'll go ahead because I mentioned what it was about in my statement. Okay. This has been one of the most difficult decisions in my 10 years on council. I've done a great deal of research and talked to a great many people on all sides of this issue, in addition to the hours of public meetings and forums. I went with Jerry last week to the ACE Task Force. We were there for over 2 hours talking to Bruce May. Greene County Prosecutor Stephen Haller was there, and our own Officer Holly was there. I believe in their commitment to what they're doing, and that they believe that what they're doing is the right thing, and that they are doing it to better this community and this region. Through this, we've heard from Dr. Halley. I'm pleased with what TCN is doing as far as treatment. Clearly, there needs to be more. They need more treatment centers. I absolutely love what Linda has presented. Brian actually and I, when we went to meet with Mario about the previous issue, we brought up to him the issue of drug activity in school, and that we want the village to be able to support what they need in the schools. And I also had the same conversation with Principal Cryer this morning. I appreciate that the chief has passionately but respectfully explained details about the task force and the reasons for his support. As a man who has spent his career in law enforcement, I understand and respect his belief that drug use and drug trafficking are against the law and not only lead to other crimes, but to the destruction of individuals and families.
It is not surprising or offensive to me that he wants to maintain our membership in the task force because he believes it keeps this community safe, exactly what we should expect from our police chief. What I've come to realize is that the burden of our membership in the task force is too much for this community to bear, though, both financially and emotionally. As a community of 3,500, we are bearing a larger comparative cost, both in dollars and staffing. It is difficult to justify the investment based upon the drug activity actually generated from Yellow Springs. In a timely turn, there was a 60-minute segment last night about task forces in Oxford, Mississippi, and North Dakota recruiting college students as informants in lieu of arrest for minor drug offenses that provided a great deal of clarity for me. Unfortunately, some of those kids ended up dead. That, along with my many meetings and conversations, have led me to determine that Yellow Springs should withdraw from the task force. But we can't turn our backs on the illegal acts that harm others, including theft, bodily injury, and trafficking to our kids. I believe we should support ongoing investigations that have legitimate ties to and impact Yellow Springs. However, I believe our police department can work locally and in concert with regional law enforcement to keep Yellow Springs safe without having an officer on the task force. I also believe the community needs to come to terms with the heroin epidemic and general drug use in the village and its impact on related criminal activity and our citizens. Together, we must do all we can to educate villagers about prevention and treatment options. We don't have the staff expertise or financial capacity to take on the development or execution of new programs like the one that Linda was talking about, but which sounds great. I'm hopeful that the passion generated in this discussion translates into citizen action and us working together as a community to get that work done. I do want to talk about two things that have bothered me intensely about this discussion that I believe go to the heart of the values of this community as much as the decision itself. While I agree that longstanding institutionalized racism exists and is responsible for continuing generations of poverty, addiction, and incarceration, to label those who favor the task force as racist and to call the task force a white supremacist organization is polarizing rhetoric that does nothing to further the discussion or invite open, honest, civil, and fair debate. Which leads to my second concern. Frustration that's been expressed by citizens that council members are taking too long and we're looking for citizens who disagree and that we're not listening to the folks who have been coming to the meetings. It's really my job and the job of every elected official to seek out minority opinions, to seek out and to hear those who feel they aren't being heard, who feel voiceless, and who feel disenfranchised. And I think you would all want that to be done if this were about a subject with which you felt you weren't being heard. So if anything comes out of this, I hope we can all respect keeping a dialogue and respect for everyone and every opinion. That's all I have to say.
I've also thought about the topic a lot, and mostly I agree that the white supremacist foundations of our culture affect all institutions. So maybe putting any one institution in a special white supremacist box is a problem, but all institutions are shaped by this world that we live in. And I believe policing around drugs ends up reflecting that racism. But for me, the task force is going to happen regardless. We're not voting on whether the task force should exist, but whether we should participate in it. And I think specifically, I have a problem with the furtherance of justice funds. I think the way, when you have money coming in, even if it's not money that can be used for salaries, it's not money that can be used, but it can be used, money is power. Right? And so to incentivize arrests through civil forfeiture for me is a problem, and it's just bad for the country. There have been a few limitations put on civil forfeiture in the past year at the federal level, but right now there are only 4 states that require conviction for assets to be forfeited, and Ohio is not one of them. So I just think civil forfeiture, I've always had a misgiving about furtherance of justice funds, and I frankly should have probably looked into it earlier and didn't understand that this was a somewhat voluntary part of our participation in this task force. I do find the quasi-public, quasi-private status of the task force to be troubling. And so that has always bothered me, that it has all of Greene County and its mission, but it gets its funding and staffing only on this kind of voluntary basis. It bothers me. I think that's a bad structure for policing. It just shouldn't work that way. And that's not anybody involved in its fault, right? That is allowed by policymakers, right? For me, a lot of the problems in this world are much more on policymakers than they are on the police officers themselves, because it's not about bad apples, it's about barrel makers, the people who make the barrels that apples get put in, and mostly that's people sitting in legislative positions like this, and at the state and at the federal level. So I really do think that our police chief and our police officers are motivated by the desire to do good. I think many people go into policing wanting to do good for their communities, but if the structures are problematic, then problems will grow and blossom, and incentivized, especially when there's potential incentive, financial incentive involved. And we are about 3,500 people. We're 2% of the population of Greene County, supplying about 5 times that amount to this task force, as I calculate it. And that does seem disproportionate on top of it all. And my screen has been doing this going blank thing on me that bothers me, and it's doing it now, so I can't read my final comments, but that is what I wanted to say. But I really appreciate the idea that Linda brought forward, that we need to start framing how we're going to be thinking about alternatives to this model.
And just to add to the financial piece, mm-hmm. the 60 Minutes program talked about that the grant money is determined by the number of arrests, so the amount of activity. Right. So that's another, you know, that's another financial incentive.
Right. And that's all set up by policymakers. That's what's frustrating. That's where I really think the blame needs to be especially put. We have policymakers in place that are creating the barrels where the bad apples get created.
Go ahead.
Well, I had a question, Jerry. You said something, I'm not sure if I understood you, that were you saying that the task force here is going, that you're not trusting the direction it's going, or?
No, what I'm saying is without having a body there, we won't know if they're doing what I saw in the 60-minute report.
Oh. We're not at the table.
We're not at the table.
We're not at the table, right.
And that's the point that I'm making. I lose my seat at the table. Because, I mean, that program, you know, was shocking.
Well, I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking, because I've said pretty consistently that I think that we should get off the task force. And I don't see it as an all good or all bad thing. But when I look at the benefits and the, what's the opposite of benefits?
Costs.
I come down saying that we should get off. And one thing is, as long as we're on the task force, we can just put that problem of addiction and crime that comes out of that onto the task force. So I agree with Jerry. I think as a community, if we think this is a problem, drug addiction, alcohol addiction, all the other things, some of the other issues that Linda named, that we need to step up to the plate and take that on as a community. And I think we can do that as a community, not in isolation, not without interfacing with the region. But I think that if we're going to be serious about it, we need to take that on as a community. And unfortunately, I think drug addiction is sort of like the tip of the iceberg in a way. I mean, frankly, I think we're all addicted. And whether it's sugar or TV or reading or being busy, when we're in a culture that is lacking a lot of things. And the people who end up being addicted to something like heroin are having to suffer dramatically for something that really is a societal problem, I think. And the good thing about Yellow Springs is we are small enough. We have passion, we have resources, and we can make a difference in our community, especially if we all work together and don't vilify each other. So I'm done.
Thanks. I'm probably going to end up echoing a few of the points, but I might say them a little bit differently. So first of all, throughout this discussion, I think that one thing that we, at least everyone I've heard, seem to be on the same page about is that we need to address the problems that are related to drug use. And certainly there's a lot of disagreement about how we do that. I do also want to thank the chief for essentially playing a devil's advocate role, to the extent that we did not really hear much on the other side until recently. And this is part of the reason why, when I started council and the amount of time that complicated decisions take to make had shocked me. And I've come to accept and embrace it, because I think we really do end up making the best decisions. And I think we will make that tonight. So that being said, I also think it's really important what Lori commented on, that it is up to us as the policymakers to direct this. And the chief and Patty have been really clear that they want direction from us. And I am confident that the decision that we make, they will then implement in a positive way. I also think about the cost-benefit analysis. So it concerns me that we've paid a disproportionate amount, given our size, to these efforts over the past 10 years. And I also believe that we've built up goodwill. So if we need that support in the future, that we will get it. I think that we know how to work with the task force because of that experience, and we can customize it to Yellow Springs. I'm very happy that Jerry has mentioned the fact that it is hard to say, okay, we're done with this approach, and not have an action plan in place. And so when I make my decision, and it's going to be to get off the task force, I have a couple expectations. One of those is all the energy and passion that's been in this room. I, like Karen said, expect citizen action. And I'm really impressed that Linda did some of that work. I mean, that's really the first time we've had something concrete. Now, Kate's made a great example, a great suggestion about a social worker. We've had some other things as well. And it's nice to see other places doing this. But I mean, it is not good to just not have a plan in place. So I'm expecting that when we make this decision to get off the task force, that citizens and we've got the Human Relations Commission are going to help address this. The second expectation I have is that if for many of our citizens, and I'm sorry, but having talked to so many people, It's not this vast majority of people that are saying get off the task force. There are plenty of people, both in public as well as offline, have concerns about this, very strong ones. So my other expectation is that if in fact the task force has been keeping these problems at bay, then this decision may change. I don't necessarily think that's true, but that is another thing that I'm looking at. Obviously I've said where I'm going to vote, but I again want to reiterate what Karen ended with. It's very frustrating when you have a council who is being responsible, not irresponsible, and is being respectful to citizens, that we hear good suggestions, but then at the same time, these sort of slams on what we've tried to do when we have many other priorities for many other citizens in this village. But I feel very strongly that this council has acted responsibly. We have listened to everyone. We've done the work for a very complicated decision. And, I'm just impressed that we've worked on this and coming to a decision that I think is right for the village. And so it's promising to me that we have some good ideas and that we will work to not just address our own problems, be a role model in the region. And so I'm finally hearing some things that are concrete in that regard. So thanks to everyone, and that's what I have to say.
Thanks, Brian. Let's call the vote. All those in favor of exiting the ACE task force, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
Aye or
nay, aye, whatever. Right, I don't know. I think you're supposed to.
Yeah.
Chris, does it matter?
Same sign.
Okay. Thank you all. This was good. Thanks. Okay, where does I lost my agenda?
You're on to old business.
Okay.
I don't think there's anything else on the agenda.
There's nothing. Okay, now we're moving on to.
Okay, and a reminder that we have to keep this door open. We cannot shut it because it's an open meeting. So,
and you're welcome to stay.
We're going to continue with the meeting, so please be respectful of that. We do have citizens' concerns if anybody's here to talk about anything that wasn't on the agenda. That's what we're moving into right now. Okay, we'll just wait a minute. We'll just wait.
Tell us. Is he asleep?
He's out.
Are there any citizens' concerns?
Anything about that's not on the agenda that somebody would like to speak about?
Okay, please come forward.
Okay. And to come up to the microphone, state your name, and you have 3 minutes.
Okay. My name is Dr. Dennis McClure.
I'm Anna McClure. I'm
my wife.
Mm-hmm. many of you, I want to say one thing right. First. Many of you may not know, that we actually have worked together as a team in a specifically focusing on opiate dependency treatment center here in Yellow Springs. We actually had a home occupation permit and worked. We saw 100 patients approximately every single month. We saw them one at a time. One thing that Dr. McClure wants to talk about is the disease of addiction and what is the current accepted way that opiate dependency is being treated right now, and some of the restrictions that we have. You guys were talking about the barrel that comes up with the legislation, that comes up with the laws, and mm-hmm. and how things are being allowed to be treated mm-hmm. all across the board. So I'm going to leave that up to my husband to talk about.
Thank you very much. You had Dr. Haley come here, who's a psychiatrist. There's another realm or another division in addiction treatment, and that's in the medical standpoint. Specifically, my training has been in neurological surgery. which I completed in 1984 and practiced for over 20 years. I became extremely interested in chronic pain in the early 2000s. During that, I found that there was a correlation not only with chronic pain, but with the aspect of depression. And then to continue that in its continuum, what I have seen over my period of time is now the presence of addiction. And so I think pain, addiction, and depression are in a continuum. It is now recognized that the treatment recognized by the medical establishment is for addiction is that of medication-assisted treatment, either with the first drug was methadone, and now there's another drug called Suboxone, or it's buprenorphine. The problem is, I also work in pain management. I'm 64 years old, and I've been a physician, as I mentioned, for 37 years. So I'm not working at just a pill mill. We're actually a very dedicated pain and addiction recovery center where I work now in Dayton, Ohio. The problem is that the DEA allows me to only treat 100 people who are addicted to opiates.
That is across the board for
across
all physicians.
Across the board and for all physicians. Okay. I can only treat 100 patients.
You can have a couple little
okay.
more time.
However, for the aspect of treating pain, I can prescribe an unlimited number of pain medications. What has happened also at the end of January this year by our Ohio government and its state medical board is now we are restricted in how many milligrams of Suboxone that I can prescribe. I can prescribe 2 8-milligram strips. However, I can prescribe an unlimited number of patients getting Percocets. Isn't that crazy?
It's completely backwards.
It should be the other way around. Our government should allow an unlimited number of patients who are addicted to opiates and heroin to be treated by physicians with medical-assisted treatment and restrict the number of pain medications. The other thing I'd like to make a comment about is now heroin is the drug of choice for white, middle-class, upper-middle-class adolescents. So why do you think it's a problem now? And why do you think the emphasis is? It had always been a problem in the minority communities. But now it is the drug of choice for the white community.
It is a chronic, progressive, and fatal disease of the brain.
The other thing I'd like to make, it does not discriminate about your race, your ethnicity, your sexual orientation, or your socioeconomic background. Okay.
To stay in treatment is much more effective, i.e. And we've seen really, really wonderful success in our treatment. We've had patients, many patients that we've treated, probably close to 1,000 or more patients over the course of 3 years' time. And many patients have completely gotten off of Suboxone, so we know it is possible. But we got to have a collective, collaborative group. And I really, really wanted to commend Linda on her suggestions as well. I think if we can coordinate that with some education about what's available and bring people like us maybe together as well, we could have a very, very powerful approach in Greene County that maybe even be a model for the rest of the community as well.
So great. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Any other citizens' concerns? Okay. Patty, it's on to your report and Melissa's report and Judy's.
Well, I did something a little bit different this time for my report. I did it says 2016 recap. It should say 2015 recap, but I did this right before I was getting ready to go on my 60-mile walk that Mary Ann noted. So it just covers a couple of things that that happened during the year and how much I appreciate the support that I've gotten from council as well as from my incredible staff to make the things happen in the village this year. I do have a couple of additional things. We had an email from Efficiency Smart, which is a company that we contract with through our AMP partners to help with things like recycling services of appliances and rebates on new, more energy efficient appliances. And the company that they have been working with, the subcontractor they've been working with on the appliance program has in fact gone into receivership. So if you have submitted a rebate to Efficiency Smart, and if you either haven't gotten your check or if you've gotten your check and gone to deposit it and it has not cleared the bank, please call my office. We have a contact at Efficiency Smart where we can in fact get you a new check. They are from now on going to be processing those rebates, so you do need to still submit them to Efficiency Smart. But if you have any problems with that, please do contact my office, and Ruth Ann will be happy to help you with that. And the only other thing I have is when I did go on my walk, one of the things that you have is you wear credentials for the whole time, and this is how they make sure they don't leave anybody out on the route at night. You actually get barcode scanned out and barcode scanned back in. And while you're walking, you collect all of these wonderful ribbons and stickers and pins and everything else. And this is a pretty good collection, I have to say. This is better than my last collection. And I did share with Brian one of my paperclip angels. So if anybody wants to look at this, it'll be hanging in my office for a while.
Nice. So. Thanks. Mm-hmm. Melissa?
Basically, my report was just highlighting what we were going to be going over tonight, such as the budget, which will go to the county, and I will make sure that that is in place when staff comes in on the 4th, so it's business as usual, and then just about the supplemental appropriations and kind of giving an explanation. So that was it.
Okay, thanks. Judy?
So I was saying it's been extremely busy. The meeting schedule for next year is done. I had some more corrections on it from Brian, so... if anybody's got anything, please get it to me by tomorrow at 11, because it's going to go in the Yellow Springs News as well as up on our website. I just wanted to thank Karen for coming and giving a rousing welcome to the many clerks who were almost left without a training Friday the 20th, and thank our community resources who leapt into the fray and made it happen.
And just related to that schedule, a few things I wanted to make sure were on record. The Community Access Panel has moved its second Thursday meeting to 7:30 p.m. And the Economic Sustainability Commission has decided to meet on first Wednesdays at 7 p.m. So just a couple details.
Oh, that's what it says.
That's what's on there.
Yeah.
But yeah, we had never really sort of officially said that.
So. Oh. So she just made it up?
Well, I mean, we decided it at our meeting, but we hadn't stated it at a meeting, a council meeting.
Way to think that. Way to figure that out, Judy.
Yep. Getting good at this.
Oh, Judy, the Environmental Commission meets in council chamber. I just noticed that you didn't include that, or that wasn't mm-hmm. included. I hadn't noticed that before.
And we did, yeah. I got Brian gave me that tip as well.
Yeah, we updated some other things too.
Okay, something we should have probably said in announcements was that we have another, we're lucky enough to have two meetings this week. We have another one December 10th at 6 o'clock to meet and hear from the two finalists for the Water Plant Design Build, Shook Construction and CDM Builders, and also
Sam Swanson from HTNB will be here to kind of lead the discussion. Council can ask questions, and that's what we're hoping, that you ask questions. And
the format for that, remember, Council, you did get a briefing in your packets a while back, that at that particular meeting, the actual committee will be up here, and if the other three council members would please have a seat right there in the front, so that you are right there and can ask the questions. And then I think Melissa and Judy and Chris will be, well, Chris won't be here, so Melissa and Judy will be in the back.
I assume we aren't planning to vote.
Oh, no.
No.
When would the vote be likely to take place?
We'll discuss it after that. Yeah. We'll discuss it that night. We'll discuss the process moving forward that night.
Right. So definitely, Judith should definitely be here, because it's quite likely that it won't happen on the 21st.
Right. Yes. It's very possible.
In other words, I really wouldn't have to be here, but I will come.
Oh, boy, you want to see it through, don't you?
Yeah. I guess so.
I'll call you to remind her.
Oh, thanks.
So, and then again on the 21st, the third Monday in December, we will have a regular session. We will be beginning at 6 to have an executive session for the purpose of the Clerk of Council's annual review. I do believe did I send those evaluations to all of you?
You did.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
When would you like them by?
Before that meeting. No, I mean, if you can, let's say by the end of this week, would that work? Okay.
Yeah, we need a reminder.
Let's see.
We need to take off the swearing in piece, unless you want to do it piecemeal. I had sent you a suggestion around that. You can do a couple of swearings in, or you can do everyone on January the 4th.
But my understanding is that they have to be officially sworn in prior to that, right?
Correct. That would be ceremonial.
Yeah, that would just be ceremonial.
So we're just taking that off completely. I didn't totally understand that, so I think that's a better idea anyway.
That would move to the
So just
fourth.
Do the ceremonial
right.
one on the
right.
fourth.
Right.
Correct.
But they will be officially sworn in prior to
that.
Fourth.
Yes.
Then we have the second reading. We have the second reading of the ordinances. I am assuming, and then it's second reading, extending the police powers, discretionary spending, something about Lori Asklund.
I saw that. I'm like,
but only if she comes on Thursday.
Yeah, I know. Right. Yes, that's right. That's why
you rescind the resolution if I skip out on the water plant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm not sure if we will have a design build contract. I'm not sure about resolution 2015-56. That's part of what we'll discuss after the 10th. The 57, 2015, that's something we will move forward with and contract, and then we'll have Judy's contract. So that at this point, that's all we have on the agenda.
You need Pete Williams back?
Oh, that's right. That's right. I'm sorry. Yes. I don't know if Pete probably will come back. So we'll have a resolution. Is it a resolution or an ordinance?
I believe it's a resolution.
It involves taxes. I bet it's an ordinance.
It's on. It's.
Okay.
It is.
Let's just say legislation.
Yeah. Resolution right here.
Enterprise zone. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Because actually what we're doing is approving the agreement that the county commissioners will make with the company.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So.
Okay. So that will be added to that meeting. And then that'll be it. We always have a way of things creeping onto the agenda.
Oh, yes.
So,
and the Monday before Christmas, my last meeting, I can imagine this thing going to midnight, just for the fun of it.
I do have a question for Marianne and Jerry. Were you going to present the two committee members tonight?
Oh, yeah, we were.
Okay.
Can we still do it?
Go ahead. Yeah, we're not. Okay. We haven't adjourned yet.
Okay.
Well.
Need some water.
This is the this is making a recommendation for the Utility Dispute Resolution Board. We have two people who have offered their services, Dino
Pallotta,
and Jane
Scott.
Jane Scott?
Jane Scott.
Yeah. Jane Scott.
Okay. We interviewed both of them. Actually, no, that's not true. This is devolving quickly. No, I have not interviewed Jane Scott. I know her well, and I've worked with her. But she was on the Charter Review Committee.
Right.
And I think, so both of those two individuals have submitted some kind of biological...
Biological welfare.
Yeah, we're not requiring DNA.
This is the drug testing. Is that it?
Yeah. Perhaps we should do that.
We have James Scott's bio on file. He has submitted his. So we're making a recommendation that we accept Dino and Jane.
Why don't you make a motion instead of a recommendation?
I'll make a motion. make a motion that...
With one serving 3
with,
years.
With Dino serving 3 and Jane serving 5 years on the commission.
Okay.
Okay.
Do I have a second?
I'll second that.
Oh, good. Thank goodness. It's only better for you with the two of you together seconding. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you. I'm glad you all remembered.
Yeah, you're welcome.
So can I get a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.